created me a clean heart. As you can see, we are following the church tradition of starting late. There's nothing in Scripture that says we must, but we do. Like I said, it's tradition. My tradition, anyways. It's great to see everybody here. It's also welcome to those who are still watching on YouTube. We welcome you as well, and as sincerely as everyone else who's here. It's really good to see all the smiling faces. And the assumption is that those who are wearing masks are smiling. So that they're not sticking their tongue out. That's just an assumption I make knowing the quality of the people who come and worship here. On a point of personal privilege, I want to say a sincere thank you for everybody that acknowledged the completion of my last revolution around the sun. Today I begin a new one. And it's my goal to do as many as I can. I think the record that Methuselah holds is still safe. But, you know, you have to set goals in life. If you have a cell phone, he said as he checked his, please silence them. You know how that I am convinced that the world can do without us for the next hour or so. Because we come together, we leave the world for this short time to focus in and worship the God of the universe. This very God who has called out to us, who has announced that there is salvation available to all of us, and we have heeded that call, and we have been adopted into his family, and we can rest assured that he is here in our midst, because he has promised us that where two or three are gathered in his name, he is there in their midst. And I think we've exceeded that quorum quite admirably. So let's keep that in mind as we go through our worship. It's also comforting to know that God hears our prayers, that not just the ones that we speak audibly, but those in those quiet periods of desperation where from the depth of your soul you're crying out to God. Without speaking a word, he hears those. He answers those. And so we do serve a magnificent God, a creative God, a majestic God. So, in case you haven't figured it out, I'm a fan. Because I know how worthy I am to be a child of God. It is not much. I don't have a very high opinion of myself when it comes to that. And so we shall begin our worship service. And as we often do, I ask that you bow and let's say a prayer. Father, we are honored and privileged to come before you this morning to speak to you as beloved children. And what's difficult sometimes, Father, is to approach you without fear, to approach you without the trepidation that one would normally feel speaking to such an awesome and holy God. But you welcome our prayers. You welcome us into your presence. And conversely, Father, we invite you into our presence this morning as we worship you. We pray that what we do here pleases you and is acceptable to you, that it honors you, and that it uplifts us all and draws us all closer to you. And we ask that you be with those who are serving this morning. We ask that you would be with our speaker, that he would have a remembrance of those things he has prepared to share with us from your word. And Lord, we pray that you hear our prayers. And as I just mentioned, not just the prayers that are spoken audibly, but those that are spoken quietly from the heart, from our seats. And we're confident that you hear those as well. And finally, Lord, as always, we ask you forgive us of our sins. For we are weak, we are flawed, and we sin. But in your tremendous love and wisdom, you have made provision for just that eventuality, that if we confess our sins, you are faithful to forgive them. The blood of your Son washes us from all unrighteousness. And so, Lord, we offer this prayer this morning in his name. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome.
Morning.
It's wonderful to see all your faces on this beautiful day. And we also welcome and give our heartfelt greetings to those who are watching via YouTube. The first hymn this morning will be hymn number 242, number 242.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord. Sing hallelujah to the Lord. Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah. Yes, sing hallelujah to the Lord. Jesus is risen from the dead. Jesus is risen from the dead. Jesus is risen. Jesus is risen. Jesus is risen from the dead. Jesus is living in his church.
To the Lord.
Oh, sing
The next hymn will be hymn number 875. Number 875. If for the prize we have striven, after our labors are won, rest to our souls will be given on the eternal shore.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms. Lean on Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on the everlasting arms.
The hymn of invitation will be number 945. Number 945. At this time, we'll have our scripture reading followed by the lesson.
I invite you to follow along in Psalms 46. One of these days, I kind of expect to see Psalms 105 on the list to read, and that will be exciting, be long, be fun. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolation on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Thank you, Freddie, for that reading. It always amazes me how simple words can really touch the heart. They reach in and grab you. You don't want to be at times that touched, upsets and everything, but that's what the Word of God can do. It's living, it's active. It goes right into who we are, what we feel, what we're glad about. Thank you for that. Today, we'll be looking at four things that have to do with God, this particular psalm, what precipitated it, what does it mean to our walk with Christ. First of all, grace to you, peace from him who is, who was, who is to come, from the seven spirits who are before his throne, from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of kings of the earth. To him who loves us, freed us from our sins by his blood, made us to become a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Just had to read that, bring us into that frame of mind, remind us who we are, who we're talking about, whose body we are. This particular psalm, I'm not going to go in through speaking about it and then preaching on it, but it, as you see in the bulletin, the insert, the subject is more, who is God for me? The question of God in our life, the question of Christ in our life, the question of the Holy Spirit in our life. We're on a path. It was given us to walk. Isaiah calls it the highway of holiness. Jesus says, follow me. Some of us have just begun on that path, that road. Some of us have been on that highway for a long time and have learned many things. But still, it comes down to the question of God in our life. So brought me to Psalm 46 because right towards the end, after the psalmist writes what precipitated this song, this psalm that they now can sing rejoicingly and victoriously, it talks about the bows and the arrows and all that stuff. Well, that's what they were facing. It was certain annihilation. Assyria had taken over many other nations, had taken the nation to the north, as God had mentioned, had predicted that they would. Well, now they're knocking on the door of Jerusalem. And people were in a bad way. Some call it a tizzy. Some people just call it a panic. They got 186,000 soldiers out there before. Certainly we're going to fall. So what does God have to say to us? Well, afterwards they put it into song, but what he had to say was, be still. Hush. Quiet. Take heed. Know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. We want to know that he is God, but we have our ways of thinking. I don't think he is. And we get all in a panic, very anxious, because we don't know. It doesn't seem like he's there. It doesn't seem like this is going to go well, whether it's personally, in our nation, at work, in the world. God says to us, be still and know that I am God. So the question of God is at the center of our life. Many questions we could go into, many areas of walking that path. I'm simply going to choose for the question, who is God for me? But sometimes we'll pose questions or express our anxiety. It doesn't necessarily come out like that, but we're wanting to know, well, who is he for me? Because I seem distracted. I seem going off in the wrong place. I seem confused. I seem to be on the wrong path, or I thought I was on the right path, but I'm looking around and I'm not sure. He says to us to be still. It's a question of God because it's hard for us to see. You know, it's like the story of the four blind men and the elephant. They're all trying to figure out what it is. They're feeling around what it is that's out there. They can't see, never seen an elephant, never whatever. And they feel different parts of it. And they say, well, it looks like a tree. It looks like a snake. It's got this. It's got that. And we're like blind people as we try to figure out who is God. But who is he for me? So I'm going to skip through some Old Testament, New Testament, because you have to take life as a whole. What does God want us to, quote, know about him? He says, be still and know that my God. Well, what is it you want me to know? I'm going to be still. What is it you want me to know about you? First thing he said to Moses, who is this God? He's the God of the covenant. But he says, I am who I am. I just am. Put any name you want to it, but I just am. But what does that mean to me? Because he's still the same God. We put a name to him. His name is Jesus. Jesus the Christ, that is. What does that mean to me? So four things that I think he wants us to know. And in all this, we need to be still. Now, I know we're still right now. But when we go out and continue with our life, we're not going to be. First, I think, is that God is with us. God is with us. Emmanuel is how it's translated. In Isaiah 6, so why don't we go there? Excuse me, not Isaiah 6. Isaiah 8 and 9, these are very familiar verses, but this is where the name Emmanuel comes from. It doesn't end there, though. And it's in a very interesting context. Isaiah 8, now this goes back, this is the Assyrian army once again. Remember Psalm 46, that's the song after the great victory that occurred in Judah. But previous to that, it was Israel in the north. It was other nations in the north. Assyria was expanding its empire, and many of the prophets, priests, whatever, said, well, God will never let that happen to us. He is our God. But verse 5, chapter 8, the Lord spoke to me again, because this people has refused the waters of Shiloah, that flow gently and melt in fear, and they melt in fear before Rezin, son of Remaliah. Therefore, the Lord, that was one of the kingdoms that was in Syria. The Lord is bringing up against them the mighty floodwaters of the river. The river is always the Euphrates. That's where Assyria was. God is going to bring the king of Assyria and all his glories. It will rise above its channels, overflow all its banks. It will sweep into Judah, not just into Israel, but on into Judah as a flood, pouring over, and it will reach up to the neck, with its outspread wings will fill the breadth of your land. So, in essence, God is, they have this question, and they're feeling that God is going to protect us, and he says, this is what I'm going to do. A series of flood that I am bringing, and it will not stop. And at the end, he says, oh, Emmanuel. He just announced how Assyria is going to come and take over Syria and all the enemies of Israel and flow into Judah. And he ends it by saying that the prophecy, oh, Emmanuel, God with us. That disaster is God with us. Band together, verse 9, you peoples, and be dismayed. Listen, all you far countries. So he's not only interested in Israel, Judah, he's interested in all the other countries that Assyria is going to take over. I want you to listen. Gird yourselves and be dismayed. Get all the ammo, all the instruments of war you want, but be dismayed. Take counsel together, but it shall be brought to naught. Speak a word, but it will not stand, for God is with us. Just doesn't match. But he was with Israel. They needed to be spanked. They needed to be taught a lesson. They needed to see the fruits of their disobedience to God. Judah would face the same thing. So Hezekiah went to him in prayer. We're about to be annihilated. They praise the Lord. the God of their covenant. And he took out 186,000 Assyrians and so much and broke the back of the Assyrian Empire. God with us. So God with us doesn't always mean what we might think it means. But that's where God is with us. He's not leaving Israel. Next time we see Emmanuel, Matthew 1, birth of Jesus, you will call him Emmanuel. God in the flesh, John says, was born. God came into this world a baby. It said to Israel, God with us, just a mere baby. Just a mere baby. And then he goes to live in Nazareth. I mean, up there in the north with those northern people that are sitting next to the Gentiles. God with us. Next time we see the idea of God with us, Colossians 1, verse 27, Paul writes about the great mystery of the gospel, of the good news. What good news? He says, Christ in us. Emmanuel, God with us, is in us. He's in the world again. Where is he? He's right here. He left his body behind. Christ, God with us. Last time, Revelation 1. Revelation 1, starting in verse 12. What do we see? Is Christ, he's up in his, sitting next at the right hand of the Father. I understand that. But you have a Roman Empire, and if you're in certain parts of the Roman Empire, it can be kind of dicey, challenging. Starting at verse 12, John in his vision, then I turned to see the voice, to see whose voice it was that spoke to me. I turned and I saw 12 golden lampstands. In the midst of the lampstands, I saw one like the Son of Man, clothed with a long robe and a golden sash across his chest. Verse 17, do not be afraid. I'm the first, the last, the living one. He's saying to the churches, those seven churches, I was dead, and I'm alive forever and ever. I have the keys of death, Hades. Now, what I write, what you have seen, what is to take place. As for the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels, the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. And Christ was in the midst of, among, back up in verse 13, in the midst of the lampstands, in the midst of the churches, among the churches, Christ with us. God is with us. He's not just up there. He walks among the churches. He holds in his hand the churches and the angel of the churches, and he walks among us. He's with us. Matthew 28, the last thing Jesus said when he was on this earth, the last thing he said to his people, I will be with you even to the end of the age. He didn't leave us alone. God with us. That's what he wants us to be still and know, that he is with us. Can't see him. Sometimes I can't feel him. Well, that's what has to be worked out on your path. And the direction that you're going when you're walking with Jesus, who said, follow me, it's to see, I'm with you. It can look like I'm not, but I am. Better question, are you with me? Are you with me? Two, God is personal. Two of the better passages, Romans 8, Galatians 4. that because of what Christ has accomplished, and with the dying, our dying in our baptism to self, being raised to now live in Christ, God's Spirit given to us and says to our spirit, testifies about our spirit that we are God's, and we cry out, Abba. We can cry out, Father. He's personal. He's not the great God who's sometimes we question. It's just, is he there or isn't he? Does it matter or doesn't it? We, his people, give the good news that no, he is with us. He walks among his churches. We are in him. And we cry out, Abba. We were given that. He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the covenantal God. We enter into a covenant through Christ. He is our God. We are his people. And he forgives our sins. He's personal. Sometimes we think, well, I was really angry with God, and Ed, I'm afraid I told him off. I'm afraid I screamed at him. I actually said nasty things about him. But I'm angry. And he says, be still. Know that I'm with you. I am with you. I walk with you. You have my spirit. And we cry out, Abba, Father. Three. Here's a tough one. Psalm 22. Psalm 22. If he is the God that is with us, he is the God that is personal to us. He is also the God, I think you would agree, that is hidden. He says, be still and know that I am God. What do you want me to know? I want you to know that, yeah, I am hidden. What better passage? It's the one that Israel sang in their worship of God. Jesus learned it as a young Jewish boy. And experienced it personally on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning? My God, I cry by day, but you do not answer. I think because you do not listen. And by night, find no rest. He wants us to assure us. He wants us to know that I'm with you, that I'm personal, but I am hidden. We sense his presence at times, and usually it's the great times, like this. When fantastic things happen, doesn't have to be big or an exciting party, but we can sense God's presence in our life. There are times we sense his absence. So which is it? Well, Jesus went through the same thing. You know that the Father, Son, Holy Spirit are there. We believe that, and we'll go to death believing that. Still, no one can argue. Where is your God? Because I can't see him. I don't feel him. Think of Adam and Eve. He was absent to them. They never saw him. Because, of course, you can't see God and live. He gave them everything, blessed them with everything, even with a challenge. Don't eat this. You eat this, you have eternal life. But at some point in their life on the new earth, there was a sense of his absence. and they went on their own. Cain's sin. God would ask Cain, well, where's your brother? Knowing full well, where was he? Why was he hidden? Why couldn't he have stood there and said, what are you about to do? But he didn't. He was absent. Israel's cries in Egypt, 400 years a slave, and they're moaning and crying out to God. And then God says, I've heard them, and I will answer them. I wonder if some of those slaves who had fathers and grandfathers who slaved and died at the hands of Egyptians wondered, where is he? We know he's here. We sense a presence. He is alive, but he is absent. We have to come to terms with that on our path, on our walk. Much as the disciples did as they're walking to Jesus, ready for him to take the throne of David, to rule over Israel, to bring about the kingdom of God, and he lets himself get beat to a pulp by the Romans, cursed by the religious leaders, sentenced to death. Brutal Roman men nail him to a cross and he dies. God was absent. Even when Jesus was on the cross at that moment. Yet you are holy, enthroned in the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted, they trusted, you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I'm a worm. Not even a human, a worm, he says. Jesus on the cross, the absence of God. And I'm sure that had to go through the disciples' minds. Where is God? Where is he? This is such a travesty. As one influence in my life has said, God has to be both. It has to be absence and presence, which I thought for a long while. And that was from a person who was, he was a minister. He was German. He had ministered to people, churches, even when the Nazis took over. He had to leave, still ministering to the church because they were where Israel was when Assyria was out front there. There were Christians in Nazi Germany right outside. Where is God? And he understood because he paid the price and he was killed by the Nazis, still believing in God, in his presence. But he came to understand he has to be. He can't be both. He has to be absent. But he is present. That's something to work out. Fourth, last, God wants us to know, wants us to be still and know, I'm looking for you. I'm looking for you. Remember Adam and Eve? God visited one time, and what was his question? Where are you? Where are you? And it's been that way ever since, God asking humankind, where are you? Job. We might think it's about Job being angry because I don't understand, I don't see you. I just want time with you. I just want to talk to you because I don't understand and I hear nothing. Nothing. And becomes dismayed with his friends, with life, everything. And then God shows up and says, ask him several questions. Can you do this? Where were you for this? It's not so much about where is God, which you can think reading through that, well, it's got to be the theme. Where is God? You know, that he's always there. But it's more, where are you, Job? Where are you? Maybe that's why it was written in the first place, to ask us. God's here. God's done this, that. Where are you? Carl. Where are you? On our walk with Christ and our discipleship for him, and I want to be like Jesus, we need to contemplate that question that he's asking us at times. Where are you? As creator, he said that to Adam and Eve. As the God of Israel, he said that to Job. Isaiah 65:1. To say to Israel, I was ready to be sought out by those who did not ask. And that's still true today. A lot of people are not going to ask about God, don't want to ask about God, don't want to know about God. He says, I'm ready. I was ready to be sought out by those who did not ask, to be found by those who did not seek me. I said, here I am. I'm over here to a nation that did not call on my name. I held out my hands all day long to rebellious people. That's the God of Israel. He's looking for us. He was looking for them. He's looking for anybody willing to be found by God. Luke 15. And this is the reason why Luke 15 is, it's a chapter, this particular time in Jesus' ministry, Luke puts it in there at a crucial moment, and he writes these three stories of people who are looking for something, a shepherd looking for his lost sheep, looking, seeking about. I'll leave those, someone can take care of those. I'm looking for this. A woman looking for her dowry. Very important. Everything stops because I'm looking for this. A father, the prodigal father, looking for his son, waiting, watching, looking for his son, and sees him afar off because he's waiting and he's looking for those prodigals. Any prodigals out here? Any prodigals we know? God's looking. God's looking. Luke 19, verse 10. Over and over again, he would say to his disciples who thought he was just, he's going to sit on David's throne, the kingdom of God is going to come. He says, no, I came to look. I came to seek the lost. I came to seek the lost. I came to die for them. I came looking for the lost. Matthew 28, we call it the Great Commission. It was simply Jesus. He's going to with his right hand of the Father, become Lord over all creation, not just the church, but over all creation, and tells his body left on earth, do what? Go and seek. Go and search. Because God's looking. Tells Paul when he goes to Corinth, and that's a hard place, nasty place. Paul says, be still. God says, be still. I got lots of people there in that city. God's looking for us. There are lots of questions we could ask, especially about what's been brought up, but when it comes to God looking for me, how do I let Jesus find me? Ever thought of that? Sometimes, like with my parents, they're looking for me, I'm here. I don't know why you didn't see me, I was here. Okay, I was up in my room, I was over my friends, but I was here. And my parents knew, well, no, you weren't here, but yeah, I was here. How do I let God find me? Am I hiding? Can that happen? Do I lack seeking him? Good questions to ask when it comes to God at the center of our quest, question in our life, of God in our life. Was God for me? He's looking. Am I letting him find me or just not paying attention? How do I let God transform me? Because he's not going to force me. He's not going to stick me in a chair like a nasty, like a, you know, a rebellious child and say, okay, you're going to sit there and you're going to listen to me. You're not going to have any choice. You're not going to eat anything. You can't go to the bathroom. You can't do anything. You sit there and you listen to me. I remember those days. It transformed me, all right, but how do I let Jesus transform me? How do I let him bless me? How do I let him bless me? Because I can refuse that. I can be too busy. I can be looking elsewhere. How do I let myself be known to him? God says, I want you to be still and know that I'm God. How can I let myself, how can I let Carl be known to him? And to let him become known to me. Is there something behind being still that maybe we should listen to? Because there's a lot of anxiety out there and in our lives. How do I let myself be known to him? How do I let myself be loved? Maybe I simply want redemption, not love. Maybe I simply just want to go to heaven. Who's going to fault me for that? But not loved. Or, a good question, if I says, who is God for me? Who am I to God? Who am I for God? Blessings go with this. I know I went over. I hope you ponder. I hope you think about. Just God says to us, be quiet, be still. And know that I'm God. Let's stand and sing.
Kneel at the cross, Christ will meet you there. He intercedes for you. Lift up your voice, lead with him your care, and begin life.
Excellent lesson. to prepare our hearts and our minds to remember our Lord and Savior's death on the cross, we will sing hymn number 496, number 496.
Oh, listen to our wondrous story, counted once among the lost. Yeah, we'll be down from heaven's glory, saving us at awful cost. Who saved us from eternal doom?
By God's Son upon the
cross.
I'll be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. And the important part is right here in the beginning. It says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" We take this time for the Lord's Supper. As it says, I receive from the Lord, that we remember what he has done for us. He sacrificed his life for us so that one day we can be in heaven with him. So we take this time to remember the significance of his body and his blood and what they mean. So if you would please bow with me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we take this bread, which signifies the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, who was hung on that cross that day. He died for us because he loved us so much. He died so that he is the perfect sacrifice, that no more sacrifices would have to be made on our behalf. It's in Christ's name I do pray. Amen. continue in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we take this fruit of the vine, which signifies the blood of Jesus that was shed on the cross that day. With him pouring out his blood out of his body, it washed away our sin. It set the new covenant. It began the church. He gave up his life for us. It's in Christ's name I do pray. Amen. This concludes the Lord's Supper. Now we take this time to remember the many gifts that God has given us. Not only did he give us his own life, but he gave us many blessings. First of all, the church here. And we take time to give back to the church so that it may continue to grow, to help pay for expenses, bring us the new preacher, and most of all, to grow the church. So if you would bow with me in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for all you do for us in our lives. You bless us in so many ways that you can't list them all. We give back to you as a token to say thank you for what you do for us in our lives. May you continue to bless us. May you continue to watch over us. May you continue to keep us safe. It's in Christ's name I do pray. Amen.
Closing prayer. I want to say thank you to Carl. It's a great question. You know, who is God to you? Sometimes we need to be reminded, you know, that, you know, God is everywhere and he does a lot for us that we sometimes take for granted. The very air that we breathe, the fact that we can come here in freedom and worship and be together, brothers and sisters, got a lot to be thankful for. And, you know, there's that song that goes, he is my everything, he is my all. And, you know, I think that says a lot right there. Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, you are such an awesome God. We truly appreciate everything you do in our life. We know, Father, that you're here as we're together. Your spirit abounds in the hearts of these people. We're grateful for what you did through Jesus, his sacrifice, his love, the dedication. So many things that can distract us from what's truly important. We know, Father, that someday you're going to come and take us home. We look forward to that day, Father, where there'll be no more tears, no more suffering, no more death. We pray, Father, that as we go about our separate way this day, that you'll help us to be mindful of those who need you and need your love. Some of us came to know of your love years ago and others just recently. Grateful, Father, for each and every one of us that is here this day. Please watch over us. May we be ready to be here at our next appointed time or be ready so that when you come back, you can take us home. Thank you for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. A couple of announcements I'll cover before we're dismissed. Let's see. We have Linda Paul with us this morning. There she was. Oh, there she is. Yeah, yeah. I spoke to her just real briefly. She is ecstatic to be able to get outside and be with you, especially, was what she was talking about. And she has a note here. I want to say thank you to everyone for the prayers, meals, calls, cards, etc. This past year, it has all been greatly appreciated. I have been recently diagnosed with a heart issue, and more tests are still being done. Also, my kidneys are already compromised. We're praying well with. They are not playing well with her heart medication. Most of all, I am thankful to be at worship today. Amen. It's good to see you, Linda. Randy Stevens is in a halfway house in Manchester and still in quarantine. Yesterday, Gene Akbar, he's here, right? Did I see Gene? He had a birthday. Yeah, you had a birthday. That's what it says. Is that true? Check emails again for prayer requests and needs. If you have any announcements, please get them to the office. That's how we distribute the new announcements, so please remember that. Let's see, Saturday, April 24th, which is next Saturday, we're going to have a cleanup day here. If you can be here, there's yard work and work on the parsonage that we want to get done, of course, with Danny coming. Not sure when that'll be. We were kind of kicking around July, but he's got a lot of things to do as far as getting prepared for the change. So we don't have a firm date yet, but it's in that. Hopefully that's the target. Saturday, April 24th, 5 p.m. will be a chili cook-off. They keep saying it's not a competition, but you know, I don't believe it. Bragging rights are probably going to be prevalent, but all are invited. So they're going to make all this chili, and if they need testers, and we need someone to eat it, because I don't think they're going to make just a spoonful. They're probably going to bring a whole crock pot full. Yeah. Wednesday, April 28th. What's this? At 3:30, walk in the woods. All are welcome for a walk at Mind Falls Park in Nashua. Meet at the entrance behind Nashua High School. Bring your kids. Oh, good. If you have questions, talk to Heather Bell. And Jerry's got a serious problem that he wanted me to convey to the congregation. He had a birthday. And he's over that. The problem is he's got this monster cake, and he needs help getting that consumed. So it's downstairs. So between the break, be sure to avail yourself of a piece of Jerry's birthday cake and help him out. There's coffee down there to help with that too. Also, real quick, just an update on the COVID situation. You should know by now, but I'm finding out many don't. The state mandates expired on the 15th, but there's still a lot of people that I guess didn't realize that. As of yesterday, zero new deaths were reported, about 370 cases. Active cases is around 3,000. There's 126 in the hospital, but about 60% of New Hampshire residents have been vaccinated or in stages of that. So that's a really high percentage. It's a lot higher than most states. But that being said, Jerry and I have always had the position that, you know, we'll follow the laws. We're not going to impose any additional restrictions or mandates of our own. Again, you're leave it up to you as to what you want to do, and you know, need to be kind to each other, whichever side or whichever you mask or no mask, whichever position you take. It always makes sense if someone's sick, stay home. I don't care if it's COVID or what it is. You know, I don't want to be around you if you're sniveling and sneezing all over the place and coughing. So, again, you know, common sense should always prevail on that stuff. And there's only 26 states that have any restrictions at all anymore. So across the country, things are moving towards eliminating all of that. But again, you know, use your head, and I'm glad all this is getting behind us. So that's all I have. So we're dismissed.